Number two, okay. So. Okay, so let's see. Which one was this? What page? Do you know? Page 17, number two.
Oh, you know, 3x plus 2 minus 3x minus 2.
Okay. Yeah. All right, so 3x plus 2 minus 3x minus 2. That one right there? All right, so on the first set of parentheses, you can drop them right away because there's really like a 1 out here. And then here, this is like a minus 1, so you have to distribute through. So you'll have 3x plus 2 here. When you distribute this through, you get minus 3x and then plus 2, right? That's what you got. And then the 3x's cancel. And you get 4. And you're saying that. Yeah? Okay. There's mistakes in the solutions. I think most of them have been fixed, but you know, it's possible. So if you see something like that and something seems off, just let me know. Okay, any others? Yes.
So from the section B, question 1.
What page is it?
17.
17, and you said which one?
Okay,
yeah, so I was thinking you would probably have some questions on this because I didn't do any geometric shapes. So let's just talk real quick because this will come up later. A couple of geometric ideas that we need to be clear with. First of all, the idea of a perimeter. The perimeter of an object. And this is really just the distance around the object. So you could look at this as the distance around an object. It's usually a length, okay? That we measure it as a length, like feet or miles or inches. So this is not referring to your questions. I'll get to yours in a second, but we just need to be comfortable with the idea. You know, like if you have some weird shape, doesn't even matter what it is, right? Like those are a bunch of little straight lines. Then if I tell you that this is 4x, I tell you this is 2x minus 1. This side here is x plus 7. This one here is 8, take away x. This one's 3x. This one's 2x plus 1. Then I could ask you for a formula that would give you the perimeter of this. And so all you do is add all those up, right? Just add them all up. So the perimeter of this would be, let's just start here, 4x, and we're just going to go around. So 4x plus 2x minus 1, then add this one, plus x plus 7. Add this one, so plus 8 minus x. And keep going, now we're here, 3x. And then this is our last one, right? 2x plus 1. And then we would just collect all our like terms. So we're not going to get a numerical answer here. Our answer is going to have x's in it, but that's because we don't even know the lengths of these sides, right? So how many x's do we have there? Let's see. 4 and 2, that's 6. Here's another 1, right? So 7. Take away 1. So back to 6. Plus 3. 9 plus 2 is 11. So I have 11x. And then as far as numbers, minus 1 plus 7 is 6, plus 8, 14, and then plus 1, so 15. This would be a nice condensed formula that would measure out the perimeter of this object. All right, so everyone clear on perimeter? All right. what about if you have a circle? That's a circle, sorry. Not a very good one, but there's a special formula if we have circles. And You need to know, yeah, you need to know what the radius is. The radius is the distance from the center to any point. And so the perimeter is actually called the circumference, but it's still a perimeter, all right? And that is always going to be 2 times pi times r. So 2 pi r. And pi here is a number. We all familiar with that? Pi is approximately, it's approximately 3.14. But you actually have a key on your calculator for pi. And I'll tell you where it is. Oh, that felt good. Where is your pi key? Let's see. Oh yeah, right there on the left-hand column there. It's the, yeah, it's the fourth button down, right? If you count that green button. All right, so you could use that if you wanted to, all right? So let me give you a specific example. Let's say the radius of this circle was, r was 2 feet, right? Then the perimeter or circumference, whichever you'd like, would be 2 times pi times 2. And if you do that on your calculator, anyone have it? What do you get? What does your calculator say? My calculator says 4 pi, right? That's what my calculator says, which makes sense. 2 times 2 is 4. But how do I get this to turn into a decimal? Anyone know how to use this calculator to go from 4 pi and turn it into a decimal? No? Yes? Second what? Did you try it? Did it work? Mine didn't work. Which one? The one above it. What does that do? You see that? That converts back and forth. Good. I'm glad you found it. All right. So there's a button on the bottom right-hand side. There's a button that has, looks like two little black arrows that are pointing in opposite directions like this. Y'all see that? That's going to go back and forth. Between, if you just keep hitting it, it's going to switch back from decimal back to the 4 pi and so on and so forth. Okay? So what we would do, and this is kind of important, this is the answer, but if we do it as a decimal, we get 12.566, and it goes on, it keeps on going. I'm using a squiggly equal sign here. That means approximately. So what we've done is we've rounded. All right, so this would be what we call the approximate answer. Approximate answer, and then this answer right here, we call this the exact answer. The exact answer has no rounding. The approximate answer has some rounding in it. Okay? Perimeter good? All right, so after perimeter, we move on to area. So area is the measurement of the stuff inside a flat surface. And there's two formulas I'm sure you've seen. If you have a square, if you have a square, then whatever this side is, I'll call it, let's call it lowercase l. Then if it's a square, this is also l, and this is also l, and this is also l, right? So all the sides are the same. That's what makes it a square. And what's the perimeter of the square? Perimeter. Around. So what would it be in this case? L plus L plus L plus L? 4L. So the perimeter of this is 4L. But the area is different. The area doesn't measure the distance around. It measures the stuff inside the surface. So if we wanted to know how much this in red was, that's a measurement of area. And what's the formula for the area of this square? Remember it? It's length times width, but since they're the same, right? Length and width are the same, it's just length times length. Or if you'd like, L squared, isn't it? L squared. That's what we get if we have a square. Now, if we have a rectangle, the difference between a rectangle and a square is what? All four sides don't have to be the same, right? So we could call this L. This would have to be L, but then we could call this like W or H for like width or height. All right, so the area of this, let me see where I am on my camera here. Go to here, okay. So what's the perimeter of this one? 2L plus 2W. So 2L plus 2W. Right, you'd have to go L and W and then L and W again. So 2Ls and 2Ws is what it would take to get around. But the area of this would be L times W. So it's this side times this side. These all look familiar? Seeing these, right? Okay. By the way, my daughter's in second grade and she had an assignment and she had to circle all the rectangles. They gave them a bunch of different shapes and all this, and she had to circle all the rectangles in the problem. And there was a square in the problem. And so was she supposed to circle that? Is a square a rectangle?
Yes.
It actually is. A square is a rectangle, all right? But I got into a debate, a little bit of a debate with her teacher because I'm like, I wrote a note on the homework. I was like, you know, technically a square is a rectangle. And her teacher replied back and said, well, they're in second grade, so let's not worry about it. Let's let squares be squares and rectangles be rectangles. But I want her to learn the right way from the beginning, so I was kind of against that. But she got all mad at me. She's like, Daddy, my teacher told me, you know, squares and rectangles are different. And I was just like, okay. But anyway, every square is a rectangle, all right? But not every rectangle is a square. So if these sides are different, if length and width is different, then it is a rectangle. But you know, a square still classifies as a rectangle. All right, now, that's area. You need to have a flat surface to have area. What about a circle? If we want to measure the inside of a circle, do we know the formula for the area of a circle? It's one of those classic formulas that you've heard in the past. We already know the perimeter of this. The perimeter we said was 2 pi r, right? That's what we just said. But the area, which is a measurement of what's inside of it, is a different formula, and it's not something that you just like know. Usually it's pi r squared. Pi r squared. So that is the area of a circle. So for area, flat surfaces, you can do perimeters of flat surfaces. Now, we move into three-dimensional space, which would be where we get the idea of volume. And not like volume on your headphones, right? Volume is a measurement of, I'm going to put 3D, three-dimensional, is that all right if I put 3D, 3-D, three-dimensional. And it's still how much is inside. So let me draw you a 3D box. So I'll show you a pretty cool way to draw three-dimensional, all right? If I want to draw like a shoebox, all right, here's the way I'm going to do it. I'm going to first draw a square, or you know, it doesn't have to be a square. Let's draw a rectangle like this, all right? And then what I'm going to do to make it have three-dimensional depth, just from this corner, I'm going to draw back at an angle. From this corner back at an angle, and then I'll just go straight across. Y'all see that? And then from here, I'm going to go back until I hit where I would be if I come straight down from here. So there's a little box. Got it? Now, I have a length here and a length here and a length here, and we usually call them length, width, and height. And it really doesn't matter which one you call which, all right? But I'll go with what seems most natural here. This is probably L, which is this side. This is W, width, how wide is the box, and this would be H, which would be the height. That agree? You agree with that? The volume of this is length times width times height. You just multiply the three sides together, and that's your volume. How about perimeter? We don't do perimeters on 3D objects like this because there's no natural way to walk around this, right? If I tell you to like go around this box, which way are you gonna go? Right? You understand what I'm saying? Like, if I start here, how do I go around this box? Like, do I go here, and then back here, and back here? Or do I go here, and up, and over, and back? Or here, and here, and here, and here, and here? So there's no, like, natural way to go around this 3D object. So we really don't have, for this, a perimeter. All right? Now, if anyone knows anything about shipping, like if you've ever gone to UPS and shipped a box, they do measure what's called the girth, which is the distance around. Okay, so like if you had to, that's usually what they use when they're trying to figure out how much they're going to charge you, right? Because they have to stack these things up, so they want to know how big the box is. So they measure the girth, which is the distance around it, and somehow come up with some price for you. What about area? This is kind of interesting. I'm curious if you can measure the area of this. Do you think it's possible to get the area of that? Yeah, we do have a concept of area here. We call it the surface area, which would be like, look at that top piece right there. Doesn't that top piece of the box have an area? What would it be? That's a rectangle, isn't it? So isn't it just the two sides times each other? So what's this side here? Width, right? It's W, and then what's this side? Length. So do you agree that the area of this, just that piece right there, is W times L? Yeah? But on the bottom of the box, you're going to have the same thing, aren't you? Yeah? So if I start putting a formula together here, I'm going to have that W times L, and then another one on the bottom. So how about we have two of those? Yeah? And then what else? How about this little front side right here? Doesn't that have an area? That's WH, right? That's W times H. And then you have a back side, don't you? So another 2WH. See, and these aren't the same. I can't put these together. And I'm almost done, but I have to do the sides, don't I? I have two sides. One side here. That's, what is that? LH. And I should have two of those. So as ugly as that looks, that is your formula for area. Make sense? Okay. All right, so now let's get to the question, all right? They even tell you here, write the polynomial that represents the total volume of the rectangular prism below. Use the formula as follows. Volume is length times width times height. So you have this, they call it a rectangular prism. Looks like some sort of shoebox type thing. By the way, today is kind of our last day of review, all right? So starting next class, we get into some new things. Fractions, proportions, conversion factors, metric system. So we start to get into things that maybe it's been a while since you've seen, or maybe you've never seen. So just FYI. All right, so I'm going to label these sides x plus 1, this is x, and then this is 4x. And they just want a formula for the volume, right? So all you're going to do is multiply those things together. Now you have to be a little careful with your multiplication because this has two terms in it, right? And so when I put that x plus 1 here, I need to put it in parentheses. I'm going to do that times x, which is this one, times this one, which is 4x. And then how do I multiply those? Like, how do I do this? Distribute? Okay, so how do you want to distribute? I agree with you, but how do we want to distribute?
So maybe we drop first. We drop the parentheses x plus 1. Yeah.
Okay, but I can't drop these unless I clear out. If it's being multiplied by something, I can't drop them. So it's being multiplied by these, right? So we need to handle that. How about we put these two together first? What's 4x times x? 4x squared? So let me write it like this. I'm going to change the order. Am I allowed to do that? Am I allowed to do that with multiplication? Yes, you can always change the order of multiplication. So I put these two together, that's 4x squared, and then I flip the order, and I think I just did that so that you can maybe see the distribution a little bit clearer, like this. So what is 4x squared times x? 4x cubed. And then 4x squared times 1? 4x squared. And you're done. Is that clear?
Yeah,
and then we'll do the other one. There's something kind of subtle in here that I like to ask students about. When you multiply three numbers together, let's say I did 3 times 4 times 5, right? Let's say I did that. Are you doing 3 times 4 then 3 times 5? Is that what's actually happening here? No, right? That's not happening. What's actually happening is you're doing 3 times 4 first, which is 12, and then that 12 times the 5, right? The only way you distribute is if this was a plus and then these two were in parentheses. Then it would work, all right? So just be careful when you're multiplying things. I put these together. Whatever that is gets multiplied through, but that's only because of the plus. All right, let's look at number 2. A countertop is pictured below. It's going to have a hole drilled in it. Right? They say the area of the entire countertop is given by this polynomial. So here's your countertop. Here's a hole. And they give you the total area, 3x squared plus 12x plus 4. The area of the hole is given by x squared plus 2x plus 1. All right. Write an expression for the area of the countertop that is left after the hole is drilled, so the shaded region. So what we need to understand on this is that this expression represents actually the area of the rectangle without the hole. Without the hole. This is the expression for the area of this circle. And so they want the area of this shaded region, which is the stuff out here. So what are we going to do? Subtract. We're going to take this, which is the area of the entire rectangle, take out this hole, which is this area, and then figure out what that is. So I'm going to be writing down 3x squared plus 12x plus 4. I'm subtracting from that x squared plus 2x plus 1. Is that correct? Just like that? I have to have the second part in parentheses, all right? That's critical. And the reason is because, really, this is the way you should write it. Here's the area of the entire thing, right? You're taking away the area of the entire circle. If you do not put parentheses here, then all you're doing is subtracting that first piece. That's it. These pieces aren't being subtracted, right? Because that minus sign does not come over here unless you put the parentheses. Then it will pass through. Make sense? So on my next step, let me go ahead and drop the parentheses. I can drop them on the first one. Now distribute a negative 1 through. So you'll have minus x squared minus 2x minus 1. Right? And what does that give you? 2x squared. Plus 10x minus, plus 3. That's it. That should be the area of the whole thing. Now, we didn't need any formulas for area of circle or pi or any of that. They just told us this was the area of the circle. This was the area of the rectangle. Subtract the two, you get what's left. Is that clear? Okay. Any other questions over the homework? You're good? Okay, the take-home packet thing that I gave you, everyone has that? This is going to be due on Wednesday, all right? So I'll put that on the board officially. So the take-home quiz. Which is how many problems here? 20 problems. Due beginning of class Wednesday. What's that going to be? Is that the 1st of February? All right, so the only thing we really didn't cover that's on there is GCF, which was greatest common factor. That's where we're going to start today. Greatest common factor. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to start this out. I'm going to kind of baby step into this. If I give you two numbers, let's say 30 and 12, two numbers, what is their greatest common factor? What does that mean? Like in English, talk to me like I'm, you know, the biggest number that divides into both. Exactly. The biggest number you can find that goes into both of those numbers without having any remainders left over. So can you just visually look at that and tell me what the greatest common factor is?
Six.
Six, right? Now, I am going to expect that everyone in this class could look at those and get that, all right? So the GCF for those two numbers are 6. All right, how about this? How about 120 and 44? Now that one's a little bit more challenging, right? It's a little bit. So do we have a more systematic way of doing this in case we can't do it mentally? Maybe 12? So how would you know for sure? I mean, if you think it's 12, couldn't you just divide both of these by 12 on your calculator?
Yeah.
Right? And you would hope to get no decimals. Does it work? 44 divided by 12 is a decimal, 3.666. So 12 doesn't quite go into both. It would go into 48, not 44, though. 12 would go into 44, right? So I wonder if there's a more systematic approach. And there actually is, but it takes a lot of time, and I don't recommend it. But I like to give you something just in case everything else fails, all right? And that would be to do what we call a factor tree or prime factorization of each of these numbers. So let me just take each number, 120, and let's just kind of split it up. Can you think of anything that multiplies to be 120? 10 and 12? Okay, and you could have used anything. 6 and 20 would have worked. Whatever you think of, put them down. And then look at those numbers. Can you break those down? So 2 and 5? I put 5 and 2. Okay, that's fine, same thing. And then what about 12? 3 and 4. And then you look at this row. Can you break down 5? 5 is prime, right? You can't break that down. 2 is prime, 3 is prime, 4 is not prime, it's 2 times 2. So you can break 4 down, 2 and 2. And then what you do, what I like to do is, since I came and I did another row, I'm just going to bring all these straight down. That's down. This three didn't get broken down. So what I have here is 5 times 2 times 3 times 2 times 2, right? If you multiply all these together, you get 120. Agreed? But I'm going to write it a little different. I'm going to write 2. I'll do it this way. 2 times 2 times 2 times 3 times 5. I'm just going to write it that way. That is 120, isn't it? Yeah? Okay. I just rearranged them. Then I have to do the same thing for 44. So anything you can think of? 4 and 11. 4 and 11. 4 times, you're not stupid. You're brave enough to make mistakes. That's okay. That's a good thing. All right, 4 times 11, right? And now does 4 break down?
Yes.
2 and 2? And then the 11? Is prime. So I bring it down, 11. So I can put it this way. 2 times 2 times 11 equals 44, right? And now what we can do is we can look at these and we can see what they have in common. So notice that they both have a 2, right? They both have another 2. But other than that, they have nothing else in common, do they? Right? This one has an 11, there's no 11 here. This one has another 2, but there's no more 2s here. This one has a 3, there's no 3s here. 5, no 5s, right? So whatever's in red is what they have in common. So if we just take those, what is that? 2 times 2 is 4, right? 4 should be the biggest number they both have in common. So that's our GCF. But see, that takes a while, doesn't it? What I would recommend instead is just use your calculator. Just start dividing each of these by numbers until you're happy. We good? Okay, so the GCF of this is 4. All right, put something else here. What's the greatest common factor there?
X squared.
X squared. Now, let me... Some people are just no problem, got it, no big deal. This is x squared. But let me just try and show you what's really happening here. Remember how we just did this? Right? If I did that for those two, wouldn't x squared be this? And x to the fifth would be x times x times x times x times x. That's x to the fifth. And then if we looked at what they both had in common, 1x here, 1x here, 1x here, 1x here. That's it, right? I run out of x's up here. So what they have in common is x squared. Therefore, x squared is our GCF. Yeah? Okay. Another one. Three of them now. If I give you three different things, what's their greatest common factor? In this case, just x, right? This one has 3, this one has 1, this one has 5. You can only pull what they all have in common, right? So this would just be x. And you could do that by listing out all three like this, and then circling, and you would see that you only have 1x in common. All right. How about this? 30x cubed, negative 12x to the seventh. Two things to look at. What do they both have in common? So I've kind of combined two ideas into one here now, right? We've got numbers in there and we have letters in there. So I recommend you look at them individually. 30 and negative 12. Is there a number that goes into both? 6, right? But you could also say what? 6 or before you get to the X's. Couldn't you say 6 or negative 6? Think about it this way. If I go back to this problem and I put negative 12 here instead, then does everyone agree that 6 goes into this? 6 times what? 5. 6 goes into this. 6 times what? Negative 2. Right? 6 times negative 2 would give you this. So positive 6 goes into both of these, but so does negative 6. Negative 6 into here. What do I have to multiply or negative 6 by to get positive 30? Negative 6 times negative 5. So it would also go into this. Like negative 6 goes into there without a remainder. Negative 6 in here, that divided by negative 6 would be 2. So when you have signs that are different right here, it's your choice. You can say either positive or negative 6 here, and both answers are correct. Do you understand you have some flexibility here? So we start with the number, I'm going to say 6, okay? 6. And then what about the variables? X cubed, right? X cubed. All right, one more and then we'll do what we need to do. How about 20 x to the third? How about negative 15 x to the fourth? And then one more, 45 x to the sixth. So three of them to look at here. Start with the numbers. What's the biggest number that you can think of that goes into all those?
5.
Could you say negative 5?
Yes.
Yes. I'm going to say 5. Okay. So 5 goes into this, into this, and into this. All right. How about x?
X cubed.
Does anyone have a question? Because we need all this in order to do GCF. This is all right?
Yeah.
Sure. Good, good. All right. All right. So when it comes to this GCF idea that we're going to do now, I mean, this was GCF, but now we're going to put it together with something else. This falls into a category called factoring. And when it comes to factoring, factoring is one of those topics that cause students a lot of issues. There's a bunch of different processes that you do for factoring. Right? There's a bunch of different things you look at, and we will talk about them more later. But the first step to factoring anything, step number one, is always GCF. That's always what it is. All right? Step two and on, we're just going to leave that as a question. So all today is about is just to review to make sure you can do the GCF step. Now, what I'm going to do is kind of illustrate this by showing you an example. If I told you to take 3x squared, and I put it in parentheses next to it, 4x squared minus 2x minus 1. If I asked you here to expand this, or in other words, multiply, that would be something that would have been fair to ask you on that previous homework assignment. Because this is just testing your ability to distribute. All right, this is polynomial multiplication. So all we would do is this, right? Multiply here, multiply here, multiply here. Yeah? So let's see what we would get. What would that be?
12x
to the fourth power. Are you multiplying the 2 times 2 to get 4 here? You're adding, right? Okay. And then what's next?
Minus
6x cubed, good.
Minus
3x squared, perfect. Okay, great. If everyone's on board with that, great. That's not what we're doing, okay? This is not what we're doing. What we are doing is we want to be able to go backwards. We want to be able to go from here back up to this, all right? So the actual operation of going from here down to here is called multiplying or expanding. The operation of going backwards from this back to this is called factoring. And this particular step of this back to this requires that we can do what's called GCF. All right? So that's what we're going to do now. This was just to get us to understand what factoring is. It's actually taking something that has a bunch of additions and subtractions between them and somehow converting it to where we have a multiplication in there instead. That's what we're doing. All right, so let's do GCF now on, let's do this one. We know what the answer should be, right? Let's just act like someone just handed us this problem and said factor using GCF. So what we do is we do the same mental steps that we did before. We look at how many terms there are. There are 1, 2, 3 terms. And it's almost like I'm sitting here doing this to you. Take that, take that, and take that and find your GCF. That's the first step. You look at all three of them separately and you say, okay, what's the GCF for these three things? So what number is common to all of those? What's the biggest number you can think of? 3 or -3, right? Your choice. So what do y'all want to go with? 3? Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start writing my GCF down. 3. All right. Now look at the letters. X squared, right? So I write that down, x squared. Once I write my GCF down, after I do that, I put a set of parentheses, and I leave myself enough room for 1, 2, 3 pieces. And the reason I need 3 is because I started out as 3, right? So when I distribute this through, I need to be able to get back that. So that's why I have space for 3 things. And now at this point, it's just you sitting there asking yourself a question. 3 different questions, actually. See this right here? We need that to come out, right? When I do this first multiplication through, I need that to come out. So 3 times what is going to give me 12? 4. So I need to place a 4 here. And then x squared times what will give me x to the 4th? X squared, so I put that here. Right? And that first multiplication through will give me this. Now I move on to the next one. I need to create this, right? So what do I multiply 3 by to get -6? -2. So we need to put -2 here. And then I need to turn x squared into x cubed, so I need an x there. And so now I've created this one, haven't I? What about this last one, though? I need to turn 3 into what? -3. How do I do that? Multiply by -1. Right? -1. So I'll put -1. And then I need to turn x squared into x squared. Well, it already is x squared, right? So I don't need any x's. So I'm done. 3x squared minus 1. Are there any questions on that? All right, I'm going to give you one. You tell me. You work on it on your own, see if you can get it, all right? So how about... Factor that using GCF. Just put your hand up real quick when you're done. Okay, you can put your hands down. All right, so who has my GCF for me? 6x? 6x, good. Could I have used -6x? Yes, but we usually like to pull a positive out, but it's, like I said, you could have pulled the negative, all right? Everyone agree? Yeah. All right, so now we play this little game. I'm going to need enough spaces for 3 things, right? So 1, 2, 3 things. That way I know how big my parentheses should be. And now... turn 6x into 30x cubed. 5x squared. Good. Turn 6x into -12x squared. -2x, right? And now the critical part that I did this intentionally to see if I could trip anyone up here. Plus one. You have to have plus one here. The reason why is because you may sit here and say, I need to turn 6x into 6x, right? So you may go, oh, it's already 6x. I don't need anything. But see, if you don't put anything here, what's going to happen when you distribute through? You'll get that first piece, right? You'll get the second piece. But then how are you ever going to get the 6x? You're not going to. So you have to have plus one here so that it distributes through and gives you that. Make sense? So I always like when I'm doing GCF to remind myself of how many pieces I need in this parentheses to recreate the three pieces here. Anyone need any more clarification on that? Sure. Okay. Let's see, I believe that, is that homework? Let me see. I don't think that's, yeah, that was the homework. So let's just look at some of these. These are pretty straightforward. Why don't you, let's take like, I don't know, let's see how long it takes you. See if you can do all six of those, or seven of those. Let's do this on a separate piece of paper. Do it on separate paper, put your name on it. It's going to be an in-class quiz. You're allowed to work with each other on it. You already did it? If you already did it, just, I don't necessarily need you to copy it. Just let me see it before when I collect everyone's.
Okay,
that is on page 18. Yep, and I'll blow that up a little bit. When you're done, turn it in, and that way I know like where everyone is. You can talk to each other if you want, check each other's answers with you, you know, make sure everyone's on the same page. Do you want me to check yours just to make sure? I mean, you probably checked them in the back already, or?
Was there stuff
about that? Okay. So it looks like you're doing right, but you need to write it correctly because, like that first one right there, the way you write your answer, you have to have that 3x and then parentheses. Yeah, because if you just if you're saying it's what you've boxed, that's not correct. If you finish up, you can just turn them in. Well, I wanted you to do on the separate paper so I could like give you a grade. Yeah. Did you wind up just rewriting them?
No?
Yeah, okay. You can just put your name on it and you can turn that in. Maybe another like 3 minutes. If you have a question, you can raise your hand. I don't mind coming around and helping you out. Yes, ma'am. Sorry about that.
Uh-huh.
Yep, all these are the same. So now, yep, same thing. Yep. Six? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does, but is that the biggest number?
No, I don't know.
Okay, so one way you could do is try it. Take six out, do it, and rewrite it all. You know, do the work, and then we'll take a look at that after you get that.
So I did this, but then I erased it. But do you want us to rewrite this, and so this would be first? And then
nope,
this?
You don't have to. Okay. But that's not completely factored. There's still a GCF there. There's still something that goes into those numbers. So you pulled a 6, but something a little more goes. So just keep that line there, but look at your numbers, 6, 15, and 12. What number goes into those? Right? So now pull another 3 out. What did you pull, 9?
Yeah.
There's still a number that goes into both those, right? 4, 10, and 8. 2. So you can pull an additional 2 out. Yep, we'll be 18. And you're going to wind up with 6 times 3, which is 18, right? 18. Because you're pulling a 3, it's multiplication.
I just did that in my head.
Yep.
I should have done the tree.
I think you're okay with what you were doing. It's just when you look at that answer, just look back at your numbers and make sure there's not something else that comes out. That makes sense there? Okay. You're taking 2 out of each of those? Yep. 4x to the 4th. There you go. Yep. There you go. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then, good. Now, look at this. You've done a good job up to this point, but just double check. Is there a number that comes out of both of those? 4 and 2.
Oh, yeah. I can't simplify.
Another 2 can come out, right? So pull the 2 out, and it'll join the 8 out front, and it'll become a 16. But do it on the next line. Just leave that line there, and just do another line below it. There you go. 16x. Close it. Yeah. There's only 2. You only need 2 dashes here because there's only 2. So. 2. You pull the 2 out, right? So 2, yes. It'll be a 2x, right? And then you pull the 2 out of this one, so that's just going to be 1 minus 1. Make sense? Okay.
What this one is?
This one right here? So try and come up with a number that goes in all those. Can you think of anything? I'm sorry?
I'm just.
Okay, I thought you said something. I thought you said something. I'll give you time.
Okay,
look, I'm going to collect what you have. I'm going to collect what you have right now. If you didn't finish, it's okay. I'm giving you a grade on just effort, all right, just being here and participating. But make sure you do those at home. And I am going to talk about number 2, all right?
Are you collecting?
Yes, I'm collecting this. Yep. Anyone else? I'm going to take attendance and give you a quiz grade off of you just turning this in, all right? Yeah, this is an easy grade. This is one of those you showed up and you played, so you get a grade. You get a certificate for just being there.
I can never take those things
out. Wait, just to confirm, we're doing 19%.
We're doing what percent?
For homework. Is it homework or is it part of the?
That's. Let me see. Hold on. Those problems right there were from your homework. See, y'all stopped right there. Now you're going to do this page for homework, which is what you just did, okay? So you don't necessarily, it's page 18. You don't need to redo it if you feel comfortable with them. All right? But if you didn't get through them all, I recommend you go do them. Anybody else need to turn in? Yeah, no, don't worry about that. You can turn that in anyway. Just make sure your name's on it. And then the ones you didn't finish, just go do them, okay? But you'll get full credit for just go do them. Working. All right, so the second one was the one that caused the most issues that I could tell. And that was 36x cubed plus 90x to the fifth minus 72x to the seventh. All right, the most common mistake I saw was that the proper GCF for the number didn't come out correctly. So I saw some people took a 6 out, which is correct, but it's not the biggest number that goes into all those. I saw some people took out, I believe, a 9. That's still not the biggest number. So what's the biggest number that goes into those? It's 18. It's 18. Now, let me show you how you could have got that. Let's take a vote. How many of you pulled 6? 9? Okay, so it looks about 6 and 9 were about equal. Let me do it I'll do it both ways just to show you you could still get the answer. If you pulled the 6 out, you should have had 6 and then x cubed. Then you would have had 6 plus, what's that? 15 x squared and then minus 12 x to the fourth. That's what you would have had if you pulled 6x cubed out. That is factored, but it's not the greatest common factor. And the way you'd know that is by looking back at these numbers and trying to think of a number that goes into those. And now it's a little clearer, isn't it?
Yeah.
What number goes into all those?
3
goes into all those, right? So what you do now is you'd pull another 3 out. So you'd have 6x cubed times, here's your 3 that you pulled out. And now you'd have to figure out how are you going to get, like you're turning that 6, you're pulling a 3 out of it, right?
Yeah.
So you're just going to need a 2 there to get it back to 6. Here, a 5, right? X squared, and then here, minus 4x to the 4th. Understand what I just did?
Yeah.
And now you put the 3 and the 6 together, 3 times 6, not plus, 3 times 6, 18. Understand?
Yeah.
So if you answer this on a test, that is not completely factored, that you did not pull the GCF out. Now, let's look at if you had done the 9. If you did 9x cubed out of this, then you would have had 4, just 4, sorry. Then plus 10x squared, and then minus 8x to the fourth, right? Some of you got that?
Yeah.
And do you see now that it's not fully factored? You see there's a number that goes into this, this, and this? 2. So you pull that 2 out, the 2 would come out, hit the 9, become an 18. This would go down by 2, that would become a 2, this would become a 5, this would become a 4, and look, it's going to match with this now, right? Understand?
Yeah.
So everybody's answer should look the same when you pull a GCF. Unless you pull a negative out front, then that's going to be a little different. But it's okay. Look, on this quiz, seriously, this grade was just you were here. It's more of an attendance grade, but I'm using that as a way of seeing who was here. All right? So I'm not going to count it wrong if you did this, but learn from it. Make sure on the test that you pay attention to those things. All right. So we're going to go ahead and start the section on percents. Let's just see how far we get. Let's see what time is it. Oh, we have 15 minutes. Yeah, that's enough time just to get introduction here. So look, percents. We see percentages all over the place, right? We can hear, you know, you go online, you look at the news, you look at pretty much anything is going to have some percentages in it. So we need to make sure we understand what it means. When we see this symbol, it means of 100. And have you ever wondered, like you know, what is that symbol? Like, what is that? This is really like a division bar, okay? And the top, that is not a zero. It's actually just like a placeholder, like something over something. All right, if I have something divided by something, right, then it would look like that, like a box over a box or a rectangle over a rectangle. Well, instead of that, they use circles. Circle something over something and just kind of twist it to the side. So that symbol means that you have a ratio, a fraction. And it always means out of 100. So when we say 3%, what we mean is 3 out of 100. 3 of 100. And if I convert that to a fraction, that's 3 divided by 100. And if I get on my calculator and turn it into a decimal, I get this. 3 divided by 100, I get 0.03. So a lot of you have been taught that if you want to convert from a percentage over to a decimal, what did they tell you need to do? You remember this? You take the decimal point right here, which is behind the 3, and you move it two places to the left. That's how they tell you to convert from a percentage to a decimal. And then to go back from a decimal to a percentage, you move the decimal point two places to the right. Does that ring a bell?
Yeah.
You remember hearing that? Yes? No? Now you heard it?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So let's just practice on that real quick. Let's say here percentage, we're going to make a table. And then over here, decimal. So I'm going to give you, what if we have 100%? Convert that to a decimal. What would that be as a decimal?
One.
One. Where's that coming from? Here's the decimal, right? Move it two places to the left. You get 1.00, don't you?
Yeah.
So 1.00, which is really just one. So 100% is one. All right, what about 75%? 0.75 is a decimal. What about 320%?
3.2.
So two places to the left, you'll still have it. It'll be right there, right? So 3.2. With me? How about 0.09%? That'll be you're moving the decimal point two places, one, two. So you're going to have two new zeros appear. And then you still have the zero that was there, so 0.0009. A lot of times when we have decimals like this, we like to put a zero in front. I usually don't, but we like to just so that you don't lose track of where the decimal is. Sometimes, like, if people don't put that, they don't write it like dark enough on the paper, you won't see it there. And then you might think, you might not know it's a decimal. So, all right, that okay? How about this? Let me go the other way. What about 0.135? Convert that to a percentage. 13.5%. All right, so going from here to here, we move the decimal two places to the right. Let's do another one. Okay, here's my table. Percent, decimal. What would 100 be? Which way are you going with the decimal? Which way is that decimal moving? The decimal's right here, isn't it? Which way is it going to move? To the right, two. So it's 10,000%. All right, how about 5.25? 525%. .0275. 2.75%. All right, so we just need to be comfortable here going from a percent to a decimal or a decimal to a percent, back and forth. We have to be used to it. Now, let's just talk a little bit more about what this, why we use it, and like how it's useful. So let's just take a poll here, okay? How many of you own an iPhone? Raise your hand. Okay, so I need it high because I'm going to take, wow, is it everyone? Holy shit. Everyone here has an iPhone? Okay, no Android users here? Hey, don't laugh. I have an Android. Okay, so, all right, everyone except me. Is that correct?
Yeah.
All right. You are all lemmings being marched to the ocean. All right, sorry, I shouldn't have said that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. And then I'm 20, right? Someone left, right?
Yes.
She have an iPhone?
I would assume.
Yeah, I would assume so, too. Why would you assume so? Because 19 out of 20 people in here have it, right? So 19 out of 20, we need to know. We'll ask her when she comes back. But 19 of 20, okay, do you have an iPhone? Android?
iPhone.
Okay, 20 out of 21. I'm counting myself in here, so 20 out of 21 of us use iPhones. All right. What is that as a percentage? Well, the percentage means of 100, right? There aren't 100 of us in here. So we need to understand when we see percentage, it's not saying that there were 100. It's saying if there were 100 of us, how many of us would have iPhones? If there were 100. We know there's only 21 of us. So how can we do this? 20 of 21 is a fraction, isn't it? 20 over 21. Now get your calculator out and figure out what this is. This is approximately 0.95238. My calculator keeps going, 0.952. And the only reason it stops is because at some point the calculator has to stop, right? That's actually going to keep going. Right? That's it. 20 out of 21 is this decimal, isn't it? What is that as a percentage? So we have the decimal converted to a percent. This is 95.238, blah, blah, blah. But at some point we can round. So how about we just say 95.2, close enough. 95.2% iPhone users. I came very close to getting an iPhone. Well, I have three iPads. I have a MacBook, but I also have a bunch of other stuff. So I know the pros and cons of both. I just like to have a little bit of control over my phone. I don't like to be forced to be part of the, you know what I'm saying?
No.
You don't? Okay, like for example, if I have some pictures or some music that are in MP4 that I've had for a while, or I've got a CD or something, an old CD that I want to pull some songs off of. Like, how easy is that to do on an iPhone? Now, they want you to buy it, don't they? But see, I just plug my Android phone in, it's a drive, and I can just drop stuff in. I like that freedom. That's all. Music and videos and stuff, huh? What, huh? I have what?
You have green bubbles.
What's green bubbles?
Oh.
Yeah, so I'm not on iMessage, right?
You don't get ready group text.
Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah, no, I understand. I understand. I get the pros and cons. I do. Okay. All right, let's do another poll here. What else? What do you want to know about each other here? Okay, how many of you work? Okay, so when we say work, let's say like more than 10 hours a week. Hands are still up. So let's see who's that doesn't. One, two, 3, 4. So we had 21 people. I'm going to consider my job a job. So I'm going to say 4 of 21 don't work. Right? So what is that as a percentage? So you did 4 divided by 21, which was approximately point what, 0.4? You got it as a decimal first, right? Oh, 0.19047, something like that. Now we convert that to a percent. It's approximately 19%. Is that good enough for you? We could round. 19%? So 19% of the student population here is not working. Yeah? All I'm trying to get at here is that we have this concept of percentage always gives you a relationship out of 100. So this 19% means if there were 100 of us, 19 wouldn't be working, right?
Yeah.
But we don't know that for sure, do we? Like if we added another, almost 80 students to get to 100? Like we can't say that that percentage would still hold, right? But it's an easy way of visualizing the proportion. Because when I say 19%, a lot of people understand that better than if I say 4 out of 21. So it's just kind of a universal way of communicating the idea of a proportion. So what we're going to work on next time is what we're going to be given word problems, okay? So things are going to start to get a little weird because we're going to have some word problems in here. They're going to be a little messy, but all of them are going to have to do with percentages. 12:15. I'm not having you sign in today. I'm taking attendance off the quiz. So everyone turn that in. Homework is just to finish up the packet and then that page 18 that we did in class if you need to finish it. Yeah. Okay, everyone have a good day. Sorry.